Hello and welcome to About Books. On this edition, we're visiting Kernaghan Books, situated in the iconic Blue Coat Building. Stockists of rare, antiquarian and fine books. We're also going to be talking to local author CJ Harter about her book, Rowan's Well. But first tonight, Kernaghan Books. Run by husband and wife, Brian and Alwyn, they boast a wide selection of physical books that range over 400 years of publishing. Brian and Alwyn are genuine book lovers and are a vital component in the Liverpool bookstore scene. Filmmaker Daniel Draper was given exclusive access, and this is what he learned.
Jane Austen said, if a book is well written, I always find it too short. Everything in the world exists in order to end up as a book. Reading gives us somewhere to go when we have to stay where we are. When asked once for a motto for what we do and who we are, I came up with read, breathe, live. My name is Brian Kernaghan. This is my bookshop. My wife, Alwyn, and I have had a shop here in the Blue Coat now for 3 years. And before that, we were 28 years in Wayfarers Arcade in Southport. As a provincial bookshop, we like to carry a wide range of subjects, and we're always looking out for those things which we think customers are looking out for. Nowadays, there's so much choice available that we have to work out what's a little bit different that people still enjoy, love and want. We see ourselves as being part of a spectrum of bookshops around the country, across the world. We pitch ourselves fairly deliberately in the middle market. Traditionally, we've carried a lot of travel books, local history, quite a bit of art, obviously a wide range of literature. More recently, we've been very fortunate to have a number of collections coming in on subjects with which we're not so familiar, so that's quite a challenge. So the counties of England, together with Wales, Ireland and Scotland, all there. And what is unusual, this is the complete atlas. Every county is there, because very often they got broken up. Somebody wanted to frame one and put it on the walls. I think for us, we see that there is just so much choice over so many decades and centuries now, that we can't represent everything that's out there. And there is, for the second-hand antiquarian bookseller, there is a need to be even more selective. It's almost like curating an exhibition, but it's a selling exhibition.
I was born in Belfast quite a while ago now, back in the early 50s. Grew up there, love the city, still do, but haven't lived there for a very long time. Belfast surrounded by hills, and lived up in the hills and had great views the whole time. From Belfast, I went to Birmingham to study, met my wife Alwyn there, and since then we've done a variety of things, but most of that time now has been as booksellers together. My love of books goes back a long way. As a boy, I grew up in a home that didn't have many books in it, but my dad did take me down to the Central Library in Belfast. And he left me free to choose my own books, which were never the classics. It was always something a little bit different. And I think that pattern has continued. There's still a lot of the key English classics that I haven't read. I might get around to it one day. But there's always so much new stuff out there and something different to find.
Is it digital or not? The speaking picture book on the outside is very plain and very simple, and yet when you open it, it's like an explosion. You can see the Liverbirds in each of the panels there, so Troughton's History of Liverpool. If you're ever looking for a good pop-up book, look out for Robert Sabuda. The very first of the Gore directories. The poem Mount Pleasant by William Roscoe in the 1770s, and this is the very first issue of it. The record of who lived where, who the business people were, these rather intricate things here. We get the cow performing. Either the very first or one of the very first programmes for that musical. Stranger's Guide was for anybody visiting the city, maybe to do business. An animal from the zoo in three dimensions, 1684. The Lives of Illustrious Men by Nippos. From the Snows to the Seas. I like optical illusional things as well. Handmade paper, watercolour quality. Printings. Quite simple, but great fun.
You know, it's always a very difficult thing to ask a bookseller what their favourite writer or book is. Certainly for this bookseller, that is the case. Because I've so many interests and there's so much great stuff out there. And if you ask me on one day, I might say Jonathan Swift, Gulliver's Travels. On another day, something completely different, a modern, maybe a travel writer.
Records of big families are easier in some ways to come by than records of everyday people. And so the history of the Darbys or the Stanley family, Knowsley Hall, this is the first edition of this published in Liverpool. And because of their involvement in the Isle of Man, has a separate section at the back there.
So, yeah, one of the great joys with the physical book is that it is designed essentially to fit in your hand. And we refer to things being handbooks or pocketbooks, so they relate to us physically. But there's a sort of little quality there which has a sweetness and yet a sort of almost savoury sort of, you know, is it mushrooms? Almost something like a wine specialist when you start doing this. One of the joys with, particularly with older ones or traditional ones, is that the binding materials are made from natural skin. That's vellum that I've got here in my hand. It's old vellum, which wears hard and long, but traditional leather, as we might see like that, loves being handled because it takes the oil from your hand and that feeds it. You can flick through in a way that you actually can't do with an e-book at all, can you? And so there's something very natural about the whole format of it. And people do love this whole sensory thing. Even as I do that, one type of paper will flick and make a sound quite different from the sound of another type of paper.
We're really enjoying being in Liverpool and adding to the existing presence of bookshops in the city. Many cities have no second-hand bookshops in the city centre these days, whilst there's three dedicated second-hand bookshops in Liverpool, and that in itself is an attraction to people to come in and have a choice within short walking distance. Customers come in all shapes and sizes. We take them as they come. Sometimes the city gent type is looking for a casual pan paperback, and the chap in the scruffy coat is looking for something very exotic and unusual from maybe some centuries ago. I think when Kindle first came out, I did take a sort of negative attitude towards it. But it's a broadening of economies. It just means there's more choice. And the physical book, in the last few years, I've seen it going from strength to strength, particularly the older book, being appreciated more for the design elements that have gone into it. People who have been using e-readers, Kindles, whatever, for some time now, are realizing that the book in the hand has values and qualities that you just can't do with electronica. So yes, I feel very encouraged and positive about the love of books and the market for those books in the future. Yeah. Reading is dreaming with eyes wide open.
Fictional Rowan's Well is a remote house on England's northeast coast, home to the charismatic Brooke family. It is the backdrop for CJ Harter's debut novel, where the beautiful, resourceful Brooke women fight to save their family despite murder and ruthless betrayal. They are confronted with events to make them question the very nature of love, mother love, marital love, and the love of a father for his son. When author CJ Harter is not in her world of make-believe, she works with volunteers to deliver poetry reading and discussion sessions in care homes for older people. Previously, she's been a community worker with deaf people, run befriending services for older people and managed home care services and worked in public libraries. She's also found time to raise two children and two dogs. And somewhere along the way, she picked up a degree in literature and philosophy. I'm here with CJ Harter, who is about to tell us all about her new book, Rowan's Well. Welcome, Chris.
Hi, thank you.
Tell us a little bit, for people who might not yet have read it, about the plot.
Well, it's one of those stories where you can't tell you too much about the plot, because there's
some... Oh, we'd have to kill me.
Yeah, yes, yes, it would kind of spoil it. But I guess it's mainly about a guy who has an emotionally deprived childhood, shall we say, and how that impacts on his adult life and his relationships and what it drives him to, which is quite extreme. It's also about friendship and family, but there is a horrible murder at its heart, shall we say.
Is that at the start, or does it work its way through?
No, it builds up, it kind of builds to a bit of a crescendo,
probably about
halfway through.
Yeah.
And then the rest of the novel is about the ramifications and the fallout from that.
Because I wouldn't describe it as a classic murder mystery. It's not really a whodunit where there's a body in the first scene and then
you're
trying to work out who or... It's more about why and how
exactly.
This tragedy has occurred.
It's more of a sort of psychological exploration, I suppose. One of my readers did actually say this is not a whodunit, it's a whydunit.
That's nice.
Which I quite liked, because I think that's what it is, really.
And you're suggesting that it's more than just one man's psychological breakdown or one man's childhood working its way out in adulthood. It's more about a cultural pressure upon people that's leading to
and it's about how it's not just about one person being damaged. That damage creates, it's like a domino effect, it creates damage all around it, I suppose, like a bomb landing and creating a huge crater. And it's looking at that, and it's looking about how somebody can come back from that if they can. You know, whether or not they can.
Would you like to spill the beans about whether it's a happy or a sad ending in terms of that, or shall we keep...
It's an unusual ending, I think. I get quite a strong reaction to the ending.
Do you say it's hopeful?
I don't know.
Not for this particular individual, maybe, but for society in general.
I don't know if it is a hopeful ending or not, and I don't know whether that sells the book, because I know some people just always like a happy ending, and I promise I will write a happy ending one day. But I'm not sure if it's hopeful or not. I can't really say. I think that's for the reader to judge.
Because
people take the ending in different ways anyway. It's quite ambiguous. So it depends how you take the ending as to how hopeful you see it.
But there is an awful lot of love, different kinds of love, familial, romantic.
There is romantic love, there's mother love and there's lack of mother love.
Fatherly devotion is something that I wanted to talk to you a little bit about, because fathers get a difficult time, I think, socially, culturally. Would you like to say a little bit about that?
Yeah, well, it's only really when I finished writing it that I realised it was so much about fathers. And that's interesting, actually, because I actually started writing it just after I lost my own father. And I thought I was writing to distract me from like the grieving process, yeah, I suppose, a bit of time out in the day from what that feels like.
Yeah.
And I thought, and this is nothing about my father, this is a wholly different story. But when I'd finished it, it's all about fathers in lots of different ways.
I think you were processing that.
I think I must have been, yeah, yeah. After, hasten to add, I had a very good relationship with my dad, which some people might not think when they read the book.
But the book is pointing to the importance of the fatherly connection.
Yeah,
the children, I think.
Definitely, and the motherly connection. But fathers are really big and really central in the story, and that relationship between father and child and when it goes right and when it goes wrong. It is a big theme in the book, yeah. Mm. Not a deliberate theme, but it's there.
What are you writing at the moment?
Oh, I'm writing, it's in first draft form at the minute. I think I'm writing a ghost story, put it that way. A ghost story, I'm thinking of it as a ghost story for our time. Again, that's more overtly about bereavement, actually. It's about a woman, focusing more on a woman this time, who is suffering a bereavement and what that's doing to her, how she's trying to live.
Do you believe in ghosts yourself?
No, I don't, but I love ghost stories. I love Victorian ghost stories.
Okay, yeah.
And I have had some ghostly experiences in the past when I was much younger, even though even then I didn't believe in ghosts. I still had strange experiences.
So having the experiences hasn't made you any more of a believer?
No, because I kind of rationalise it somehow.
Okay, yeah.
What I do think is there's much more going on with our brains than we know, that we don't access. Our brains are doing things that we don't know they're doing. So I think our brains are more powerful in suggesting things to us, and our imaginations are very strong when we're not necessarily aware of it. And I think that is at the bottom of a lot of ghost incidents, if you like.
This book's called Rowan's Well. Mm. Why?
Because Rowan's Well is the name of the place where most of the important action happens. It's a house on a cliff, as you can see
I love the front cover. I don't know how much I would see it here on camera, but it's gorgeous, just beautiful.
And it's in North Yorkshire, on the North Yorkshire coast, around the Whitby area. I love that whole area, and it's kind of there's a beach that's very important in it, and that's influenced by the village of Staithes in North Yorkshire, just north of Whitby. But it's also kind of influenced by Lulworth Cove in Dorset, which is the opposite end of the country. So it's called Rowan's Well after that house, but also because there's a character in the story called Rowan, who is pretty central to the story. So you could take the title as having two meanings.
Yeah, okay. And do you think that the geographical location of it is important, that the house is vital to it? Because houses are vital, I think, in ghost stories.
Yeah, yeah. It is to me. I think for me, when I'm writing, I need to have a very strong place. I need to place the story somewhere that I know well, even if I've made it up. The beach that is central to the story, I have made up. It isn't actually Staithes Beach, and it isn't Lulworth Cove. It's kind of a mixture. But I need to have that really in my head quite concretely. And what I'm writing now, actually, Fitful Head, is based very much on a place that I know really well, which is a country park where I walk my dogs every day.
Oh, nice.
And when I was writing that book, I was writing it in my head whilst I was walking the dogs at Pennington Flash. And Pennington Flash and its atmosphere really influenced the atmosphere of the book, even though it didn't feature in the book. So for this one, I thought, well, actually, let's make that explicit and let the book be based at Pennington Flash. So there's lots of strange goings on at the Flash.
Okay, that's really cool. Mm-hmm. So do you write every day?
I try to.
It's a discipline. I know a lot of people who do it like
that. Yeah, yeah. Although I do get distracted. I'm a trainer as well, and I deliver creative writing courses, so that takes a bit of time as well. But I try and concentrate on the writing, particularly this is a vital time really in the next book, the first draft stage, and then looking at what needs to be done to it to move it along to publication, be publication ready. So that is quite intensive
Rowan's
work.
Rowan's Well is published, it's actually a beautiful level of production. Tell us about the publication of that, how you
right,
got
it.
Right,
it's published by Feeder Read. Which is actually part funded by the the big lottery.
Okay.
And that's why I was attracted to them, actually, because I used to work for the Reader organisation.
Yes.
And the project I managed with the Reader organisation. It was funded by the Big Lottery, and we had a really good relationship with them, so I thought I'd go with Cedary because of that.
And was that an easy process for people who are at home who are keen to get their own stuff out?
It's hard, actually. No, I won't lie. It is hard. It's there's a lot of work in the actual publication process, and to make sure it's the best it can be, because you know, you owe it to yourself to make sure you publish something that is of good quality for the reader. I think otherwise it's insulting to the reader. And you know, I would never go ahead with it unless I was 100% certain that it got to that stage. So it's not an easy process, but it is a really, really rewarding process.
Is this the same press you'll use for your next?
I think I will. I have been asked actually by a small press to go with them, but I don't want to. I want to go on my own now. Now I've done it once. So that's a bit in the air at the minute, but I think I will go it alone, because I have full control over what happens with that book.
I think that's important, isn't it?
Yeah.
Who do you rely on editorially to help you drive the material?
I have around me a group of other writers who are excellent, and they're really good. I rely on myself. Actually, I did all the editing and proofreading on that first time round, because I couldn't afford to pay anybody to do it. But then a professional editor did read it.
Didn't I'd want to delegate with my one.
I know.
So it's like, I think I'd want to keep
over. That's it. And anyway, she read it, and then she was asking me who my editor was, and I said, well, me. And she actually didn't believe me, because she thought it had been professionally edited. So I thought,
well done.
Yes, I thought. So gave me a bit more confidence as well with the next one, but I don't rely on myself, obviously.
You're writing full time now, aren't you? Is that an enjoyable process, or do you miss the Reader organisation?
I really miss the Reader organisation. It's fabulous. I think you've talked about the Reader on this programme before, actually. It's an amazing organisation, doing some fabulous work, and often I sit and think, you know, that was my dream job when I got it, and I gave it up to write, which that's because I love writing even more than the Reader organisation.
How did you start writing?
Well, I started, it was about 12 years ago when my dad died, actually. I'd done bits and pieces of poetry and stuff like that, but not to publish, just for my own purposes. And I wasn't writing to publish, I was just writing to get something out of the system, I suppose. Yeah. I think there was something about getting through that circle of life that, you know, I'd gone through everything, sort of birth, marriages and deaths now. And so I thought I could write, I had something to say after I'd had a bereavement, I suppose.
Well, thank you very much for coming in to talk to us about Rowan's Well, and good luck with the next story. So that's Rowan's Well by CJ Harter. Thank you for watching About Books. We'll see you again soon.